the meeting to order. Here, Tom Jones.
Here.
Mike Blau.
Here.
Carrie Johnson. Here. Let's stand for the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Goodbye.
Thanks. See ya.
Before we get started tonight, I would just like to acknowledge this is a really difficult day for RPS and the volunteer community. This week, we've received a couple different notices about tragic passings that people have had RPS community. Everybody is dealing with that now, and it's very hard to acknowledge that as a board, and that we have kind of a quick and somber meeting tonight. So that said, do we have any comments from visitors?
No, I'm just trying to put the light back on.
We're not sure where the audience is.
Next up is our consent calendar, which this month. This month, we have our board meeting minutes from our August 12th, as well as our student enrollment numbers.
Second.
Okay, a motion by Mike, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Please, we have our superintendent on the floor.
Wonderful to be here, as Erin said, it's a difficult week. I will say, though, that overall, I think the school has gotten off to a wonderful start. It's just wonderful to see children back in the building. And, you know, they're wearing their masks, they do what's called, what we call the zombie walk. It's watching them as they walk around and put their social distancing and stuff. But it just is a testament to, you know, again, why we do what we do in education. We love being around the children and you know, seeing and educating them. And, you know, it's just, it's heartwarming after, you know, all the challenges that we had. One of the things I did want to mention, I wanted to talk to Erin about this, is that, you know, as you know, you did some different things with, as far as trying to meet the physical education and movement needs of the district with, you know, with staffing. And I had an opportunity to watch a new music teacher engage in that, and it was cool. I mean, it made me want to get out. I mean, I heard everything from, you know, AC/DC to, you know, Beethoven, and I mean, he just had, you know, Do Re Mi. I mean, he's amazing. And it's just, again, the kids were just eating it up, and, you know, it was wonderful. So, you know, I think making that integration and those connections for kids, you know, like, you know, if you didn't always like music class, well, it's not just music. How do you integrate? They were really getting into it. So it was wonderful to see. As you know, Rich is not here this evening, and I know Lindsay is here to speak to a few things in his report, and I know you have something you're going to share with the board. I will just say and highlight that, and you may talk about this as well, is that, you know, unfortunately, as we know, COVID is still here. And, you know, the strategies that are being put in place are working. You know, Rich reported there have not been any cases. And, again, that report was done, and we know things can change quickly, but it sounds like good. So we're getting the high side. We're in a good place, and that's very comforting, especially as you're hearing in the news. There's a lot going on, and you know, if we continue to stay the course, but we'll also continue to work and look at the protocols and adjust if needed. So not, it continues to be a fluid situation, a fluid document. One of the things, as I have become superintendent and in this role for a little over 2 months now, is that, you know, there's things they don't necessarily teach you in when you're in college and for being in this role, and that's about busing. And, you know, one of the challenges with any start of any school year is busing. And I've seen that in both districts that I work with, getting kids on buses, the right buses, on time, getting kids from here to there, stops, everything. It is an incredibly complex system. And as we know, like when we start anything, even though we on buses all the time, it just takes us a while to get into the routines and things. And, you know, I think overall, folks have been patient. I know that Rich is monitoring very closely. I met with him yesterday about the afternoon and, you know, how can we make some adjustments. You know, once we see the plan and then once we see the reality of what it's looking like, how do we make adjustments? If there's concerns, you know, about where we're at, please know that it is definitely something that's on, that is on our radar, and that we, that Rich is actively working on. And I talk with her student on a daily basis, multiple times a day, as we continue to try to work through this. I know that there was some concern in the community about the Marshwood run and that Thursday day, and I just wanted to address that. Aaron and I had a number of conversations about that. And, you know, I think there's, it's a situation that, you know, hindsight being 2020, if I had a little more information, perhaps, that I may have chosen to do a few things differently. But I'm also learning about the relationship between bus company, school district in Marshwood, school district here, and our SAU office. And I think what I took away from some of that, you know, concern is that we still need to work on what those communication strategies are. So, you know, when Aaron called me yesterday and we talked about, you know, that people didn't know that the bus was going to run, you know, I didn't realize that that was, you know, is that something that the SAU office, you know, puts out that information. And so I was very fortunate that, you know, we strategized the way information out. Of course, I know it was late and I apologize for that. The superintendent, Mr. Cavalli, over in was incredibly helpful because I don't have access to disseminate information to the students, Bronson students that attend Marshwood. I don't have a database, I don't have a system, so I can't do anything to disseminate information to them. So we work together, and I think that's what, you know, again, what's wonderful. And again, I apologize for the lateness of it. It was certainly not something that, you know, was an intentional oversight. I think it was part of the, you know, the transition. You know, what we were trying to do was to look at a bus contract that came in much higher, and the board had some conversation about this. We bid out that contract last year and realized that actually they were using 5 buses, but only to pay. And so the cost, when the bid came back, the cost was significant, about $120,000 the first year, correct? Yeah. So that's, so how do we do that, deal with an amount that significant, not having planned a budget for that? So the option was is to continue with the 3 buses, and that then triggered other decisions that had to be made. So that's how we ended up here. And I know that that's not necessarily what everyone thought it was going to be or what they would want, but that was the decision that was made. So, you know, I just wanted to share that with the community. And again, I apologize for the frustration. Like I said, I've learned a lot about buses in the last few weeks, and we'll continue to do so. And again, we'll work to, you know, to facilitate stronger lines of communication between two districts and our office of bus companies so that we can, you know, avoid future concerns and missed information. And that is what I had shared.
also apologize for the lateness of the messaging about the late bus on Thursdays. That could have been handled better for sure, and it definitely highlights a need, as we already mentioned, for us to improve our communication, especially with parents and Washoe students. And that was something that we talked about as a board at our retreat earlier this summer, and we are working on that. But the main message, I think, is that running the three buses was really a financial decision, increasing $520,000 just to be able to have really those two extra buses that one morning run would just be cost prohibitive. I know that the SAU office worked very closely with the bus company back and forth several times, and with CBS and with Marshall to try to find a solution that would work within our budget, and that's where we ended up. The breakdown came where when we didn't communicate that properly to the parents of Marshall students. And it was kind of a perfect storm with COVID last year. There was no late Thursday. A lot of changes this year, so I apologize for the lateness of that message. We will work to do better next time. Anyone else have any questions or comments?
I guess I'm just curious, is there anything we can do to address it? How late is the start on Thursday? I mean, I don't have a child on it, so I obviously don't know what impact it is.
I mean, the high school starts at 9. I believe everything shifted by about an hour and a half.
So the students are sitting there for an hour and a half and study hall basically before school starts.
Correct. Or they can, you know, get a ride into a carpool and come and put in a good time.
Is there anything we can do to at least look at it? Are there options? I don't know. That was my only thought. I think we did due diligence when we looked at it initially, but yeah, that slipped through, so now we take a second to look at it, or is it a done deal, is it nothing?
Okay. I guess all I would say is that I think one of the things I'd want to do is I'd want to find out how many students are riding the bus and sitting there. I mean, you know, you have a number of students that go over there, but how many students are you talking? Students that are sitting and waiting, or are you talking 20 students? You know, so I think that might be a data point that would be helpful. You know, is this a bigger need, or is it just because we want to try to accommodate this? So I want to know that, and I think if you want us to look at other options, we certainly can. But anything you have, you look at will come at a cost. Right? I think if that's, you know, that's what they're trying to do with, you know, that again, I wasn't a part of all of that dialogue last spring, but I believe that was the plan, was to try to reduce that, we had budgeted for that, especially that significant. But if you wanted to look at it going forward, then perhaps you could certainly look at it.
And we met with our students just recently, even if you paid for those buses, they weren't guaranteed that they could staff the cars initially. So I'm not even sure that.
I mean, we can certainly explore that, but I mean, we're fortunate that we do have the bus, the drivers that we need, but that's not the case in any district, so we may be limited just on the personnel, I mean, we certainly can, that's the issue.
I know this was late breaking last night, so it would be great to have a data point that you're saying this affects 20 or 100 people, like, that would definitely affect our decision making, I think, here. If it is indeed 100 people, though, I mean, yeah, maybe we do want to consider looking into options, but if there is a significant amount of impact on this,
then
it
might help you to say, okay, maybe the $127,000 is something that we need to look and try to budget for, or some kind of solution, or if it's a handful of students, you're like, well, you know, you lay that out against other priorities and needs, which is what's tough, but.
When you think about it from a high school's perspective, though, I mean, having an hour and a half or whatever to get ready for the day, I mean, that's just an hour and a half plus homework that we've been before.
Yeah.
I guess you're not going to see as many juniors and seniors utilizing the town hall cars.
Yeah.
Or just not showing up. And then the middle school, that may be where they, ridership is.
Right, because you may have a hundred kids in the middle school that are taking out how many students. There are.
If I'm not mistaken, we went through this too with the Lakers.
Oh, yeah.
So that was a lot of it. But, we did have some parents that were concerned about that. But again, I think you're going to see it a lot less of this in the later grades than in the middle school.
Right, and if you said, well, maybe we only offer it for the middle school, does that impact? So I mean, I think these concerns explore all of those things. We can gather that data, we can talk to our student and the school, the schools and see what they're seeing for actual usage as a place that needs to start the discussion.
And also part of that, are we paying a stipend for that pre-supervision care or whatever you're giving there? So how much is that? Is that just rolled into the tuition? Is that part of the first student tuition increase or?
I believe it's $8,000, so it's much less than $127,000.
So we do know the figure on that.
That's something that I ended up, to kind of close that loop on because there was a discussion. From what I understand, there was a discussion that happened before Bob's left in June, but it didn't sound like the final inking on the agreement was finished. And so I have spent a lot of time talking to different folks back and forth with the superintendent and trying to figure that out and come to that figure and kind of have an official agreement so that we can have that. So
I did have one thing, and I mentioned it to you earlier. I think this highlights what we talked about last year about the same times. We spent a lot of time talking about RGS, obviously, because we have much more into the operations here, but I do still feel as a board member disconnected from what's going on over at Marshall, and I don't know how we bridge that gap. This clearly highlights that.
Yeah.
You don't necessarily have a good communication flow between their board, the superintendent, and us over here on this side. I know like Aaron and Tommy to get their information because they have students over there, but those of us that don't have students, we have not anymore.
I'm the only one now.
I was just Aaron, okay. Well, it's difficult. So how do we bridge that gap? And that's really, how do we increase the communication and keep an eye on the fact that our students out of Rollinsford that are over there are still under our charge to make sure they're getting the proper education, that they're getting everything available, resources to do.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, Mike. The chair of the Marshall Board has been talking about having this joint meeting. And it's been, both districts trying to get back to school and COVID and everything, but I think now's the time we should set a date and get together and talk about some of these challenges and opportunities that exist.
I would just add, you know, I think, you know, it's absolutely, you know, you're gonna have a little, you know, a conduit between, you know, the two districts, you know, having a discussion, you know, perhaps just, you know, engage their, you know, appetite to have, but, and some of the things that they're concerned about. Because again, you know, we don't know what they're concerned about either, so it's sort of like a pretty big silence. You know, in the past we've had joint board, they were really, you know, not great. But their superintendent is different.
Yes.
I think or might be black, we just felt like we were, you know, tense coming into these meetings, so it was a little bit difficult. But I think if we are, you know, genuine concerns, you know, because the parents really need to know what's happening. And there may be some changes over there that we're not aware of. We're still in COVID, so things may not be quite the same.
And I know they have a new principal at the middle school, because I know when I was trying to, like, who I need to talk to about this, and talk to him, he was like, oh, we're in eighth grade. And this was like the middle of August. I said, okay, well, welcome. So I think you're right. I think it's just, you're always, there's changes is the constant, and how do we continue to, you know, again, keep you both in that loop together, especially if you have a brand new administrator who may not really understand, like, doesn't know or doesn't have that full kind of understanding about what this, you know, they have students from this other district, you know, and what you're looking for in that relationship that you have with them. So you don't schedule like a regular joint meeting every year. It's kind of like that when it seems right.
So we used, we tried. Yeah. We tried, and I think it was maybe twice a year. But they will always reschedule or cancel. John was sick. I can't go.
But now this is.
Yeah, and he's.
And we have this close here. But, you know, if we have a, you know, a good agenda of things we're concerned about, again, it's making sure the parents are just aware of what's going on. You know, how can we get that information?
Marshall does a really good job from a parent's perspective with that type of communication. So it's really the things that affect Ron's very specifically and the disadvantage that we can talk about.
But if you bring them, because if they have a good, you know, line of communication, they should have all the kids and all of them. So, you know, it's, you know, what are we missing?
Yeah, I think it's an awareness and just a conversation of, you know, we send these types of messages from our SAP, but we can just give them to you and work together to really learn as well. And I think that they would be open to that, and that it's been receptive to that feedback, so it would be a really productive conversation. We just have to have it all.
If they don't have an appetite for a joint board meeting, maybe it's just two of us and two of them.
I think they do. It's just been a matter of, like, setting the date. So I'll reach out again to their chair and say, let's do this.
We wrapped up our 10th today already. It, like, has flown by, but safety protocols are in place. Kids are doing awesome with masks, distancing, frequent hand washing, cleaning. They've done so well settling back in routines, and it's so nice to see the like joy that they have to be back in this building and have a regular routine. We have Ed 500 students coming from UNH to six of our classrooms this year. So Ed 500 is like an intro to education. They get to come and spend 60 hours over the semester. They're in the process of finishing background checks and all of that stuff, but most of them have already met virtually with their cooperating teacher here, and they're super excited to get in and get to know education and our kids. So we're excited for building that relationship back up with UNH. We've had Ed 500 students in the past, but it's been a few years. Fall has been adjusted a little bit from Rich's report that went out to all of you. Those of you that are parents here, you got the little flyer yesterday. But it's going to be spread out a little bit more in order to allow for students to share their classrooms and their teachers and their learning, and allow for some distancing and protections that make everyone feel safe. So we're going to start a little bit earlier. We're starting at 5:30. Each family's been given a 20-minute slot, and then we'll wrap up about 6:30. However, in addition to like trying to limit the number of people on campus at once, we're going to forgo the picnic this year, which is kind of about my new position has been exciting and interesting. I am up new every day, it feels like. Currently, I'm working with the literacy team. We are screening all students in reading just to get a picture of them after last year and where they're at in order to support teachers in the classroom and where they're starting, and then also screen for students that possibly would be in need of intervention. I've also screened all new students for math. And then I'll be working with students in classrooms third grade through sixth grade, beginning after my literacy training next week. And I also have the opportunity this week to work with some teachers about being proactive with some behavior interventions and some positive strategies in order for all students to feel successful. So that's been
I can report back to the things that were in the hot
expressing her interest in being on board. Olrin, her letter, she was on the SAU withdrawal committee years ago, and she also is a retired educator with over 30 years of experience in New Hampshire, I think. So she will bring that with her to the board. And since Shelley was our lead applicant, I'm very happy to invite her to join the board with us. We have an action item to vote on that a little bit later, but in the meantime, does anyone have any questions for Shelley? Thank you, Shelley. Next up is the SAU104 website.
So I know Karen and I talked a little bit about this. As you know, that as part of the separation from SAU56, you know, everything used to live with Austin and Salisbury on that SAU56 website. Some of them are moving on to a separate SAU website. So I know that that Caroline Brown has taken the lead to create one that's an SAU104. So I will say it still continues to be a work in progress, but she has been regularly updating it. I know the challenge was just connecting with the SAU office staff. I think she sent up a video, and I was watching that today, just to, you know, this is how you read updates and things, because our responsibility will be as it is, as it always has been. Now has access to Blackboard Connect, so that's very positive. We worked on that a lot this week as well, yesterday. I think he has what he needs there, so that's critical. I mean, we know that when we don't have those systems that we just rely on, like I said, it's only for our students that don't have access to other schools, which is part of the challenge in our other conversation. But anyway, so that's moving forward. So it's taken a little longer than we had anticipated. But we're getting closer every day. So I don't know if there were other things about the website that we wanted to discuss.
No, I thought it would be good to get an update on that. And that sounds good. I'm glad to hear Blackboard Connect is back up because it's been missed.
Yeah, they have been a more of a challenging vendor than the car school and things. It's just nothing has worked very seamlessly. And we're going to do some training or some other little pieces that need to be done. But it's good. But again, the SAU, it's SAU104.org is the website URL. So, I think, that if there's feedback, I think it's fair to say, this is a work.
Next up is the SRP safety funds.
impact, and Katie will talk about this, but just to put a little bit of additional context in, and we can have a bigger discussion about this. I think facilities, you know, walkthrough will help kind of help me perhaps make some decisions, but ESSER 3 is one of those COVID response federal dollars that we received. We will talk about, you know, what we've received so far. As Aaron and I talked about, there's been so many different pockets and buckets of money that it's which one is this and how can it be used? So, you know, facilities, some things like HVAC, things like that are allowable, but there have been other things that you've made decisions on as far as tapping and things along that line. But we do have to submit before we can start to expend those funds what's called a use of plan. So it basically articulates, I just finished the one for Summer Storm last night, and it just articulates to do, how you've made public aware of this. And again, it's fluid because these funds are available for a number of years. So
we just want, kind of wanted to give you an overview so far. I know it's been a while since we, you know, we've talked about all these different pockets of money as they come to you, but we're talking about the review. So the first grant we received was the CARES grant. That was the original one. Problem was allocated just over $13,000. It's pretty much spent at this point because this is a year and a half ago, I think we got this money. So to date, we've spent $13,344. That's $8.10 left. We did 15 Chromebooks, 160 Chromebook cases, headsets, and various PPE and mini products with that money. And then the second round of funds was the ESSER 2 funds. That was a little bit more money. It was $69,811. We brought this to you, I think, last year, and we discussed we were going to use it for the summer boost program that we funded over the summer for our summer program. We had salaries and benefits in for an additional teacher slash interventionist position. And then with the remaining funds, we did additional PPEs and supplies. So far today, we've spent around $10,643. That was basically the summer boost program. So we still have a balance there of $59,167. And then the third round of funds, as Lori mentioned, are the ESSER 3 funds. So allocated to Robinsford is $156,889. So far we've spent zero because we need to do the use of funds plan in order to access these funds. So we have not allocated any money for these funds. So once the board discusses and we do the walkthrough and come up with a plan of what we want to use the funds for and submit that, then we can go into the grants management system and put the activities in.
Thing too with ESSER 3 is that set aside.
Yep.
The learning loss set aside of 20%, right? Mm-hmm. So approximately, if I did the math correctly, it's a little over 31,000 set aside for learning loss. And that could be the summer tutoring program. It could be, you know, to have an after school tutoring program. It could be a number of different things along that line. But you have to do that. You have to have some kind of learning loss set aside. But that leaves you don't jump. leverage other things and perhaps we can do some things. So that's the, I mean, the conversation.
What's the timing of when the ESSER II and the ESSER III expire?
So the ESSER II runs through 2023, and the ESSER III runs through 2024.
And that's the end of our fiscal year?
Yeah, yeah. Sometimes they run into, I think they're September 30th.
So that's the government fiscal year?
It's what?
The government fiscal year, the federal fiscal year?
It depends on the grant. We have some grants that end June 30th, we have some that end September 30th. It just depends on the program.
So it's nice you don't have to mail something. You don't have to make a decision right away, but you will want to use it for capital improvement and lead time for planning, securing an architect or energy. You have those kind of conversations as far as trying to deal with some things. So you have time, but you also depend on when you what you need to do. So anyway, just kind of putting that all out there from the board's back after we, you know, our next meeting after we've done that walkthrough and may have some other guidance for you around, like, well, we're going to use these funds for more account improvements and maybe do something like this, if that's what we're going to
do. Now we're going to zero out the CARES grant.
We order like a PPE item, I'll just use $8.10 out of the CARES and eliminate that. That one, I believe, is
going to
expire
anyway,
so I'm
spending it all in one place.
I know. I have a mask or
something. Just something to consider. We had talked about other improvements within the building, but I think this might fit as well into this category as far as how we expand the education. If we ever time this again, we did talk about an outdoor classroom at one point, so that might be an option. That would have potentially helped us, you know, save some classroom time by being able to be on the books. I know we talked about that last fall.
Yes.
We're
always wishing we had done that before COVID. We voted not to.
Can you help refresh me on how that 2.5% works? So we have 1 year, we spent our entire budget, we can use that? Is that
you can't just use it, there's an approval process, you have to go to the state and ask them as an emergency expenditure. There's certain items you can use it for, I think facilities is one of them. It's not just an audit.
Okay, but if we don't, then we go
it just
back
goes back
to
through the tax, you know, setting process.
So we hold it for basically one year.
Off the top of my head, I don't know. Thank you. really have much of an update for the current 21-22 budget. We are still hiring and entering new staff in the system. We don't like to give a first budget update until we have all the staff in the system so we can encumber the salaries and benefits, because that's the largest part of your budget. So by giving what it's going to look like, we have all of this money available, but we really don't. We're working on getting all that encumbered, and then probably, I'm guessing your next meeting, I'll have a full report.
Okay, for new business, we had one policy tonight, it's BEDG, and it's about minutes. Very interesting reading. Does anyone have any questions or concerns about this on first reading? We will not vote on that tonight, we'll vote on it next time after we meet again. So we're up to action items, and I will take a motion to approve Shelley Levy as our school board member.
I make a motion to approve Shelley Levy as our board replacement. All right, we'll have to get out.
Okay, motion by Mike, second by Curry. Further discussion? Okay, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, welcome, Shelley.
Thank you.
So if you will make your way down to town clerk at some point to be sworn in, then it will be official. I will send you an email as well. Is that it?
We will need her to fill out some paperwork for the SA office to get signed up and send.
Okay.
I can email you. Do you have my email?
Yes.
I'll email you and send you information.
Thank you. Next up, we have some upcoming school activities. Lindsay already talked about the RGS open house. That's on the 15th. Then the week from this Saturday is Salmon Falls Family Fun Day. It's a free event for everybody, culminating in fireworks. It's always a good time. And then the first PTO meeting is here at RGS on September 22nd. I believe that's in person. And then we have our future meeting dates here for October through January. I think some of these start at 5:30 for budget. But we moved that last time.
Are trying to keep the annex in an area and the main building separate, so I'm wondering if there's like a few factors that are going on.
It may not just be volunteers in the building, it may be specific activities, so, but we'll find out for you.
And then you were talking about the website and coordinating with cafe services and so forth. So there was a glitch at the beginning of the year that our lunch menus did not get onto the website. So we were sending kids to school and we had no idea what lunch was. And I was...
The link is on the SAU 56 website, that is correct. And then, like I said, I'm making sure that they're going to get on the SAU 104, but it is currently on the SAU 56 website.
Okay, because I talked to the first week of school to find out whether I would send my kids to a hot or cold lunch. And
there's free lunch for all, too.
Yes, and that was going to be my next question. When we do go back to paying for lunch, will we be able to pay for lunch like we have in the past with cafe services?
Yes.
And then, another question, I've lost it. Yeah, email you.
Any other comments tonight? Comments from board members?
I have one comment. Thank you for creating SAU 104 letterhead. I was really excited to see stuff come home from the school that you went for on it, honestly. I know it might be, but it's good. I mean, we are our own district and we have our own SAU, so thank you for doing that.